In this section, we will discuss superconducting tunneling, Josephson effect. First, we will study single particle tunneling. Consider two metallic conductors, 1 and 2. They are separated by an insulator. Here, an insulating material is there. First is conductor. Two conductors, they are separated by an insulator. If the insulator, the thickness of insulator is sufficiently small, then there is a finite probability of particles, probability of electrons impinging on the insulating material that can pass through the second conductor. That effect is called a tunneling. So when we separate the material, separate two conductors by using an insulating material, and the thickness of insulating material is sufficiently small, then there is a probability of tunneling of electrons from one material to another material. And the thickness of insulating material, it should be very small. It is of the order of 10 angstrom or 20 angstrom. So the electron can tunnel from one conductive material to another conductive material through the insulating medium, provided its thickness. The transmission probability from one conductor to another conductor depends on the thickness of insulating material. And the junction obeys the current through the junction at a low potential. The current through the junction, variation of current through the junction can be drawn like this, which obeys Ohm's law. That means V and I are proportional. So through this junction we can draw the current like this. Now consider one material as conductor and another material as superconductor. This is superconducting material. They are separated by an insulating medium. If they are separating, Gaver in 1960 showed that if we take one of the materials as superconductor, then also there will be a transmission of electron from one medium to another medium. In that case, the VI characteristic curve can be drawn like this. So when the voltage exceeds a particular value, we are taking that as critical value. When it exceeds beyond that value, then it will be V is proportional to I, and below that the current is not appreciable. It is very, very small. The electron density in the case of superconductors, the electron density in normal conductor, we know the variation of electrons. So this is the Fermi level. At the higher temperature, some levels above the Fermi level will be occupied and some levels below the Fermi levels will be vacant. This is occupancy in normal conductor. Now take the case of superconductor. In the case of superconductor, this is the occupancy of superconductor. So here the Fermi level, this represents the Fermi level, and there is an energy gap between these two levels. This represents the occupancy of normal electrons and this represents the occupancy of superconducting electrons. And to make a transition to normal electron, in superconducting state they are Cooper pairs, they are in paired state. To make it normal, we must give an energy. That energy is given by Eg. If I take delta as the separation between Fermi level and one energy level, then here also the separation is delta. That means Eg equal to 2 delta. To make the conductor normal, we should provide an energy gap Eg equal to 2 delta, where delta is the separation of this energy level from the Fermi level. For making this transition, we require an energy, free electrons in conduction band and the super electrons, they are separated by an energy gap Eg is equal to 2 delta. So if I give a potential V, then the work done is QV. QE is the charge of paired electron here, the charge is 2E. So we can write 2EV equal to Eg. QV equal to Eg, or 2EV equal to Eg. Eg is 2 delta. So V will be delta by E. So when it exceeds delta by E, then the super electrons make transition to normal electrons, and hence when the voltage increases beyond that, then this will behave like the case with the normal electrons. So there is a transition, the relation is similar to that of normal electrons. Now we will study Josephson's superconducting tunneling. In Josephson tunneling, we are taking two superconducting materials. This is superconductor 1, then superconductor 2. They are separated by an insulating material. This is an insulator. The thickness of insulator is very, very small. That is called a weak link. So if the two superconductors are separated by an insulating material whose thickness is very small, then there is a finite probability of transition of electron pairs from one superconducting material to another superconducting material. this insulating material is called weak link. Its thickness is of the order of 10 to 20 angstrom. Actually, if I take two superconducting metals, then the metal oxide itself formed on the surface can act as the weak link between the two superconductors. In the absence of any electric or magnetic field, we can have a tunneling current between these two superconductors. The direction of current depends on the phase difference between the electron pairs in these two superconductors, and that effect is called DC Josephson effect. So in DC Josephson effect, a DC current is flowing between the superconductors even in the absence of any electric or magnetic field. We know the particle probability density as I equal to n raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta. Psi r equal to n r raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta r. The Schrodinger equation for electron pair, we can write it as time dependent Schrodinger equation. We can write it as I h bar dou psi by dou t is equal to h psi. Now I take t as the transition probability from one superconductor to another superconductor. The number of particles, number of pairs transmitting from one superconductor to another superconductor in unit time. If T is the transition probability, then its unit will be unit will be second raised to minus 1, or its unit is hertz. So H bar T will be having the dimension of energy. If T is having dimension of hertz, dimension of frequency, then H bar T will be having the dimension of energy, which represents the transmission probability from one superconductor to another superconductor. The Schrodinger's time dependent equation for superconductor 1, we can write it as I H bar dou psi 1 by dou T is equal to H psi 1. This H psi 1, actually T represents the leakage of psi 2 to psi 1 or the leakage of psi 1 to psi 2, which represents the probability of leakage, probability of transition from one superconductor to another superconductor. So we can write h psi 1 as h bar t psi 2 and h psi 2 as h bar t into psi 1. So instead of this equation, h psi 1, if I take h bar t psi 2, then it will be I h bar dou psi 1 by dou t equal to h bar t psi 2. In a similar way, we can write the equation for electron pair in superconducting material 2 as I h bar dou psi 2 by dou t is equal to, it is equal to h psi 2, or h psi 2 we can write it as I h bar dou psi 2 by dou t equal to h bar t psi 1. So we have the Schrodinger equation. We have the Schrodinger equation for electrons into superconducting materials as, we have the equation as I h bar dou psi 1 by dou t equal to h bar t psi 2. I am taking this as equation number 1. And I h bar dou psi 2 by dou t equal to h bar t psi 1, equation number 2. The solution of this equation, the psi 1 and psi 2, the particle probability amplitude can be written as psi 1 equal to n1 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 1. Theta 1 is the phase of electron pair in first superconductor and the wave function in second superconductor. It can be written as psi 2 equal to n2 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 2. Equation, this is equation number 3 and this one is equation number 4. Taking the differential of this one with respect to time, dou psi 1 by dou t. Dou psi 1 by dou t, we can write it as n1 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to i theta 1 into I first function to differential of second one. Differential with respect to t e raised to I theta 1 to I into dou theta 1 by dou t plus differential of first function 1 by 2 n1 raised to 1 by 2 minus 1. It is minus 1 by 2. Then dou n1 by dou t into e raised to I theta 1. E raised to I theta. This is differential of this one. And psi 2 we know, the equation for psi 2. Substituting this value of psi 2 and dou psi 1 by dou t in equation 1, we get equation 1 becomes I h bar into dou psi 1 by dou t is n1 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 1. Here on I is there. I dou theta 1 by dou t plus half n1 raised to minus 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 1 dou n1 by dou t is equal to h bar t. Then psi 2 is n2 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 2. From these two equations we can write n1 raised to minus 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 1 common. And h bar will get cancelled. This I am taking to right hand side. So here we will be getting n1 raised to minus 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 1. Then n1 raised to minus 1 by 2, when I take n1 raised to minus 1 by 2, we will divide by n1 raised to minus 1 by 2, that will come in numerator, so it will be n1, here I is there, I, n1, dou theta 1 by dou t, plus, here it will be 1 by 2, n1 raised to minus 1 by 2, e raised to I theta 1 is taken outside, so it is dou n1 by dou t, is equal to, I is taken to right side, so 1 by I is minus I, so it is minus I t n2 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 2. These two terms I am taking to right hand side. When I take these two terms to right hand side, we can write it as 1 by 2 dou n1 by dou t plus n1 dou theta 1 by, here I is there, I n1 dou theta 1 by dou t is equal to right hand side. When I take these two terms to right hand side, it will be n2 raised to 1 by 2 divided by n1 raised to minus 1 by 2, or it will be minus it n1 n2 raised to 1 by 2. Then here it is e raised to I theta 2, and this one divided by e raised to I theta 1. So we can write e raised to I theta 2 minus theta 1. So this equation we can write it as theta 2 minus theta 1 is phase difference between the electron pairs in both the in superconductor 2 and superconductor 1. That theta 2 minus theta 1, we can write it as delta. Delta is the phase difference between the wave functions in two superconductors. I am writing it as delta. Then e raised to I delta, this can be written as 1 by 2. I am writing on the half dou n1 by dou t plus I n1 dou theta 1 by dou t is equal to minus I t n1 n2 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I delta. Now we can equate the real and imaginary parts on both sides. When we equate the real and imaginary parts on both sides, left hand side the real part is 1 by 2 dou n1 by dou t is equal to, right hand side the real part will be e raised to I delta is cos delta plus I sin delta. This we can write it as 1 by 2 dou n1 by dou t plus I n1 dou theta 1 by dou t is equal to minus I t n1 n2 raised to 1 by 2 cos delta plus I sin delta. So I into I square minus 1, so this will be plus. The sin delta term will be real one, and cos delta here on I will come, so cos delta term will be imaginary part. So when we take the real part on right hand side, it will be t n1 n2 raised to 1 by 2 sin delta, or we can write it as dou n1 by dou t is equal to 2t n1 n2 raised to 1 by 2 sin delta. So this is dou n1 by dou t. Equating the imaginary part on both sides, equating the imaginary part, left hand side the imaginary part is n1 dou theta 1 by dou t, right hand side it is cos delta minus t n1 n2 raised to 1 by 2 cos delta. Or we can write dou from this equation, we can write dou theta 1 by dou t. Dou theta 1 by dou t is equal to minus t n1 will come in denominator, so n1 raised to 1 by 2 by n1, that will be n2 by n1 raised to 1 by 2. So it is minus t n2 by n1 raised to 1 by 2, then cos delta. So this equation we got, and from that equating the real and imaginary part, we will be getting dou n1 by dou t equal to this one, and dou theta 1 by dou t equal to this one. In a similar way, we can solve the second differential equation. We can solve this equation. First you find dou psi 2 by dou t, then psi 1, substitute the values of psi 1 and dou psi 2 by dou t in equation 2. We will get an equation similar to this one. And from that, equating the real and imaginary parts, you will be getting dou, instead of dou n1, we will be getting dou n2 by dou t. We will get that equation as minus 2t n1 n2 raised to 1 by 2 sin delta, and dou theta 2 by dou t as minus t n1 by n2 raised to 1 by 2 cos delta. solving the second differential equation, we will get dou n on dou n2 by dou t and dou theta by dou theta 2 by dou t. Comparing these equations, these two equations, comparing these two equations, dou theta 2 by dou theta dou t and dou theta 1 by dou t. Here it is n2 by n1 the whole raised to 1 by 2. Here it is n1 by n2 the whole raised to 1 by 2. We are taking both the superconductors identical. If we take identical superconductors, then n1 equal to n2, then n1 by n2 the whole raised to n by 2 will be same as n2 by n1 the whole raised to 1 by 2. So from these two equations, we can write it as dou theta 2 by dou t is same as dou theta 1 by dou t. So from that we can calculate dou by dou t of theta 2 minus theta 1 equal to 0. Dou theta 2 minus theta 1 is delta. Dou delta by dou t is equal to 0. On integrating that, we will get delta is equal to a constant. So here the phase difference between the wave functions in both the superconductor 1 and 2 remains constant. Delta equal to constant. From these two equations, we can write it as one is minus and another is plus. So this will be dou n2 by dou t same as minus dou n1 by dou t. The decrease in electron, decrease in pair density in one superconductor will be same as the increase in electron pair density in another superconductor, and that rate of change of electron density will determine the current. So the electric current will be proportional to dou n2 by dou t. If it is proportional to dou n2 by dou t, dou n2 by dou t is minus 2t n on n2 raised to 1 by 2 sine delta. That means the current will be proportional to sine delta. Or we can write it as I equal to I0 sine delta. Here we have shown that the delta phase difference remains constant. That means we will be getting a constant current between the superconductors, and the direction of current that determines the that is determined by the phase difference delta, and the maximum value of current I is I0. That means here we are getting a constant current or a DC current between two superconductors separated by a weak link without any electric and electrical magnetic field, and this effect is called DC Josephson effect. We can have constant DC current between the superconductors even without any electrical magnetic field, and it is called the DC Josephson effect. Now we will discuss the AC Josephson effect. AC Josephson effect. In AC Josephson effect, when we apply a DC voltage, a constant voltage between the superconductors, we can have AC oscillations, RF oscillations between the superconductors. This is called the AC Josephson effect. Here we are applying a potential V. When we apply a potential V, we can take the energy, potential energy as, potential energy is equal to Q into V, or it is for electron pair we are having charge 2e, so its potential energy is 2ev. This is the magnitude of potential energy. So if I apply a potential difference V between the two superconductors, then between that two superconductors there will be a potential energy difference of 2ev. So to make a potential energy difference of 2ev, we are giving EV in one superconductor and another EV in another superconductor. So we can write the Schrodinger equation as, earlier we have written the Schrodinger equation as IH bar dou psi 1 by dou t is equal to H bar H psi 1, which is same as H bar t psi 2. Then here I am giving an energy minus EV, and the second superconductor, the equation is IH bar do psi 2 by do t is equal to h bar t psi 1 plus EV. I am giving plus EV energy with this one, minus EV energy with this one. So the total energy difference between these two will be 2 EV. This minus this one, so we will be getting 2 EV energy difference between that. Instead of giving that total energy to one system, we are dividing that into EV energy, which is given to both the systems, such that the potential energy difference is 2 EV. So this is the differential equation. In a similar way, we can solve this equation. Psi 1 is n1 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 1. Psi 2 is n2 raised to 1 by 2 e raised to I theta 2. Then find the differential of psi 1 with respect to t. Then find the differential of psi 2 with respect to t. Differential of psi 1 with respect to t we can substitute here. Then h bar t psi 2 value we can here minus EV into psi 1 is there. Minus it is h bar t psi 2 minus EV into psi 1. Here also h bar t psi 1 plus EV psi 2. So substitute this value of psi 1, psi 2, then dou psi 1 by dou t. Similar to the DC Josephson effect, we can obtain the expression for AC Josephson. A similar equation similar to this one we can obtain in this case. In a similar way we can calculate the expression for dou n 1 by dou t, dou theta 1 by dou t, dou n 2 by dou t, and dou theta 2 by dou t. I will write down that equations here. In a similar way, we can write the equation dou n 1 by dou t. We will get the expression for dou n 1 by dou t as 2t n 1 n 2 raised to 1 by 2 sine that. Then we will get the expression for dou theta 1 by dou t as this dou theta 1 by dou t we will get as EV by h bar minus t n2 by n1 raised to 1 by 2 cos delta. Here one additional term will come, it is EV by h bar. Here EV is there, then in that derivation we have divided by h bar, that's why this EV by h bar term is appearing here. I am taking this as equation number 1 and this one as equation number 2. Now in a similar way, the second differential equation I h bar dou psi 2 by dou t equal to h bar t psi 1 plus EV, the second equation is I h bar dou psi 2 by dou t equal to h bar t psi 1 plus EV psi 2. So that equation, solving that equation, we will get it as dou n 2 by dou t is minus 2 t n 1 n 2 raised to 1 by 2 sine delta. This is equation number 3, and we will get dou theta 2 by dou t as instead of plus EV, we will be having minus EV by h bar minus t n1 by n2, which is n1 by n2 raised to 1 by 2 cos delta, equation number 4. From these two equations, comparing these two equations, dou theta 1 by dou t and dou theta 2 by dou t, to eliminate the second term, we can take the difference of 4 with 2. Taking 4 minus 2, 4 minus 2, left hand side it is dou theta 2 minus dou t minus dou theta 1 by dou t, or dou by dou t of theta 2 minus theta 1 is equal to right hand side minus EV by h bar, minus EV by h bar, this term will get cancelled. So it will be minus 2 EV by h bar. Theta 2 minus theta 1 is, theta 2 minus theta 1 is delta, phase difference. So it is dou delta by dou t equal to minus 2 EV by h bar. On integrating that, we will be getting delta equal to minus 2 EV by h bar t plus a constant of integration. I am taking it as delta 0. T equal to 0, delta equal to delta 0. So we are having the phase as delta equal to delta 0 minus 2EV by h bar t. Earlier, in the case of DC Josephson effect, we have the phase difference delta equal to a constant. In this case, delta is a function of time. It varies with the time. So when we calculate the current is proportional to dou N2 by dou T, or which is proportional to dou N1 by dou T. When I take this dou N2 by dou T, dou N2 by dou T is equal to minus dou N1 by dou T. If we take identical superconductors, then N1 and N2 are the same. That's why these two terms will get cancelled. We are taking identical superconductors. So N2 by N1 is same as N1 by N2. These two terms, dou N2 by dou T is equal to minus dou N1 by dou T. And the current is proportional to dou N1 by dou T or proportional to dou N2 by dou T. If the current is proportional to this one, then it will be proportional to sine delta. So we can write the superconducting current through the junction as I proportional to sine delta, or we can write I equal to I0 sine delta. In this case, delta is not a constant, which is a function of time. So we can write I equal to I0 sine delta 0 minus 2EV by h bar into t. If I take this term as omega, then we will be having I equal to I0 sine delta 0 minus omega into t, where omega is equal to 2EV by h bar. So this current will oscillate with a frequency. In the case of AC Josephson effect, when we apply a DC voltage V across the junction, between the junction we will be having an oscillating current whose frequency is 2EV by h bar, and its maximum value of current is given by I0. That means we can obtain AC current between two superconductors separated by a weak link by applying a constant DC voltage between the superconductors. So this is called the AC Josephson effect. This AC Josephson effect, when RF oscillations are produced between the superconductors, so it will be emitting photon of frequency 2EV by h bar. If we measure the frequency of emitted photon, frequency of photon involved, and the applied voltage, if we know omega and V, from using this equation we can calculate the accurate value of E by h bar. So using this AC Josephson effect, we can find the value of E by h bar. This principle also we use in the case of magnetometers for measuring, for constructing sensitive magnetometers, where we can use the principle of AC Josephson effect. One example is SCUT. SCUT is an acronym for superconducting quantum interference device. Here we are using two junctions. Here I have taken two insulating material. This is material A, and here another insulating material B. I am passing a current J through it, and it is dividing into two parts. A current through the junction A is taken as, current density is taken as JA, and through the junction B the current density is taken as JB, and theta 2 minus theta 1 is the phase difference between the currents reaching the point 2. So we are having two junctions in this case, and two junctions A and B. So the total current density J total, we can write it as JA plus JB, or we can write JA as J0 sine delta A plus JB as J0 sine delta B. Delta A is the phase change occurred due to the passage of current through junction A, insulator A, and J, delta B is the phase difference occurred due to the passage of current through junction B. We know that it will undergo a phase change. Earlier we have written delta equal to delta 0 minus 2 EV by H bar. So the 2 EV by H bar into T. The phase is given as delta 0 minus 2 EV by H bar into T. So these two will be having a difference of 2 EV T by H bar. Both the junctions will be, the current through the junctions will be having a phase change of difference of 2 EV T by H bar. So this delta A we can write it as delta A equal to delta 0 minus, I'm writing it as EV T by H bar, and delta B we can write it as delta 0 minus, taking the delta 0 plus EV T by H bar. In flux quantization, instead of writing like this, this QT is used for measuring very small magnetic field. So if I produce a magnetic field B perpendicular to the surface, it is pointing out to it, and if phi is the flux, if phi is the magnetic flux, then we have shown that theta 2 minus theta 1 is phase difference. So delta equal to theta 2 minus theta 1, that can be written as theta 2 minus theta 1, that phase difference is an integral multiple of 2 pi. That phase difference is integral multiple of 2 pi. And the flux trapped inside a superconducting ring, if I take this as a superconducting ring, then the flux trapped inside the superconducting ring, phi, we know that phi equal to n into phi 0. Phi 0 is 2 pi h bar by q. q is 2e. So 2 pi h bar, or we can write it as h by 2e. It is phi 0 is h by 2e. So from that we can calculate n as, n is equal to, this is phi equal to n into h by 2e, or we can write n as 2e phi by h bar. So n is 2e phi by h bar. So we can write, instead of 2 pi n, oh, I have made a mistake there. Instead of 2 pi n, actually let it be h bar. I am representing in terms of h bar only, h bar. So it is 2 pi h bar by q. So phi is n into 2 pi h bar by q. So 2 pi n, I need a term 2 pi n there. So instead of writing phi in terms of h, I am writing in terms of h bar only. Here I need 2 pi n. So 2 pi n we can write, 2 pi n equal to q phi by h bar. 2 pi n is q phi by h bar. So q is 2e. So 2 pi n we can write it as 2e phi by h bar. So this will be phase difference, delta will be 2e phi by h bar. That means the total phase difference should be 2e phi by h bar. We are having a path through A and another path through B. That means the phase difference of wave traveling through the insulator A can be written as, delta A equal to, I am writing it as delta 0 minus E phi by h bar, and delta B as delta 0 plus E phi by h bar. If I write like that, total phase difference delta A, delta B minus delta A, delta B minus delta A will be 2 E phi. We need a total phase difference of 2 E phi by h bar when I pass 5 field lines through the superconducting ring. So the total phase difference we can have delta equal to delta B minus delta A, that will be equal to 2 E phi by h bar. So in this equation, I am writing delta A as taking J0 common, we can write delta A, sine delta A as delta 0 minus E phi by H bar plus delta B as sine delta 0 sine delta 0 plus E phi by H bar. On simplifying this, J0 into sine A plus sine A plus sine B, so it is sine A plus D by 2 into cos A minus D by 2, so it is sine, when I take the sum, then A plus D by 2 will be sine delta 0, then cos A minus B by 2, minus of this one, 2 E phi by H bar by 2, so it will be E phi by H bar. So we will get an expression for current density as, okay, 2 is also there, 2 sine delta 0 cos E phi by H bar, or we can write J equal to 2 J0 sine delta 0 cos E phi by H bar. So this represents the variation of current density. So this depends on the magnetic field intensity. So by measuring the current, we can measure the magnetic flux linked with the superconducting ring. From that, we can measure the magnetic field intensity that is used in superconducting quantum interference device, that is used for measuring very small magnetic field. When we draw the variation of this one, we will be having a pattern, an interference, a pattern, overall pattern like this. Actually, this is a combination of interference and diffraction. This peak represents interference and the overall represent diffraction. It is equivalent to the diffraction pattern obtained for two slits. We can consider A and B are two slits, and each slit in a diffraction, we have studied each slit, it will be having diffraction and there will be an interference of waves from both the slits. Just like that, we are having an interference pattern and a diffraction pattern. The overall structure is diffraction and each oscillation represents the interference pattern. From that, by measuring that current versus magnetic field, we can by measuring that current and its oscillations, we can measure the magnetic field. And this magnetic field, using this instrument, we can measure very low magnetic field. So the AC Josephson effect is used for measuring very low magnetic field. Such instrument is called SQ. Okay, thank you.